Don't forget to subscribe to Basement Tales. Just go on Apple, iTunes, or wherever you get your podcasts and hit that subscribe button. We release a podcast every Thursday. That way you'll be sure not to miss an episode. Welcome to Basement Tales with Sam Jackman, Charlie Einsman, Ed Grass, and Sandra Delancey. We have fun telling crazy but true stories about turning the worst possible property disasters into bags of money. Along the way, we'll pass along some important lessons to help you make cash on real estate. Sam and Charlie walked away from Cubicle Hell 25 years ago. Starting with no property, they created their own Clear Sky group of companies, sold hundreds of houses, bought dozens of rentals, and made millions in hard money loans. I'm Ed, a big firm litigator until muscular dystrophy made me find a hobby other than suing people. I miss it. Sandra's the normal person here with a real job plus some rentals. Her decades of friendship with the group, from office flunkies to property gurus, might help keep us all humble and focused on learning something. I wouldn't count on it.
We do have a topic this week. It's come up, but it's come up even today. But before we get to the basement tale, so I'm going to talk to you a little bit about post-pandemic massage. If you go for a massage after you haven't had one in the pandemic, and I normally get a really hard Thai massage, but I said, you know, I can't go with a hard one this time. And so if you haven't, it's like a chiropractic adjustment. If you haven't done it in a long time, it's pretty rough. They laid me flat on the table, and suddenly all this acid pressure is on my stomach, and suddenly I'm feeling bad, and I'm thinking I might like explode on the table, and she's just twisting me in different angles. I can't get loose. It was horrendous. She said I was so stiff, and this is post-pandemic. So that's what you do when you get vaccinated. Try that gross experience.
That's the hardest. The hardest thing that Sam faces in his day, in his work day, is the massage too much pressure.
Yeah, this is too much pressure. That could be the title for today's episode. Too much pressure.
Oh, that's actually a really good title.
Mm. Yeah, you said you had something. Something happened.
Oh, something happened. All right.
We got
to the bottom of something that's been bubbling for a year.
Oh, no. Is it more fraud?
No, it's a hustle, but it's not a fraud.
No, it's a hustle and it's a pressure, but it's not a fraud.
Yeah, there was a pressure. Pressure was applied.
Yeah.
Uh-oh, my shirt's green. I'm disappearing.
Yeah, you have a house in your neck.
Our podcast listeners are probably wondering what you're talking about. Like, I don't see anything.
I don't know about you guys. I get some really good feedback from people listening to this damn podcast.
I do.
And so
I do. I get a lot of good feedback.
It doesn't make any sense. Nothing makes sense in this world.
Let's just have this whole episode should be how great we are. Let's just talk about how great we are.
I get a lot of people, I mean, from various groups listening, and then people that I would never think listening is listening. Jeff Levine being one of them.
Jeff, hello to you if you're out there. All right. So we've got a good one today. We gave a loan about a year ago, sight unseen, for a house that would have been worth 700 grand all day. We gave first position loan of 250K. It was to an LLC. We didn't ask another question. It made steady payments, and we didn't think about it again until it came up for renewal. And then we got to the bottom of why this person had a loan and what in the world is going on. Charlie, why don't you take it from there?
All right, here we go. So this particular address, and obviously we can't say the address, but it's in Columbia Heights, Washington, D.C.
A nice area.
If you're not familiar with Columbia Heights, it's a northwest address right there off of Georgia. And the house went to a foreclosure sale unbeknownst to us. And so as Sam said, at the time, it was a 2019 tax assessment was $591,070. And the auction date was January 22, 2020. All right. So this auction happened before COVID. So this plays a part in the story because no one knew COVID was happening. I guess we kind of knew something was going on January 22nd when it went to auction. And the winning bidder purchased it for $474,000, give or take. It was either 474 or 475. And as Sam said, he thinks the house was probably worth 750. My guess, it was probably worth between $800,000 and $850,000. But either way, he bought it for 474. And the property was 100% occupied with somebody in the real estate field. And so they knew a little bit about DC and DC law. All right.
So this is, but this all is before your loan. The foreclosure happened.
Yeah. We didn't even know that. We didn't even know that till today.
Right. So the foreclosure happened January 22nd, 2020. And then our loan went out June 1st, 2020. Right. So basically, the way it went for our loan was that I get a phone call saying, will you give such and such a loan in Columbia Heights?
It's an LLC.
Will you give them a loan for $250,000? Oh, by the way, the property's worth $800,000 to $850,000, and we're going to be in first trust position. So as I told the owner of the house today, you know what we said when somebody asked us that request? We said, hell yeah, we'll give that loan.
Give us the wire instructions.
Exactly. Yeah,
send the wire instructions and we're going to send you the term sheet and we're going to get paid, right?
And you're in first position with this $250,000.
Mm-hmm.
You don't ask what's going on with this loan?
No, because we're in first position. It's an LLC, non-owner occupied property. And
they need a first
we class. Just say this, they need money. We don't need to know why.
Well, there's plenty of good reasons. There's plenty of good reasons why you would do that.
They might have had bad reasons.
I'd want to know why, but you know, okay.
There's 250,000 good reasons why we would make the loan.
So one thing that showed up early on is that there was a payoff for First Trust, a $98,000 First Trust.
Right, because so
a lender were familiar.
Other reasons to do the loan.
So and then there was a payment on the HUD to a person who facilitated the loan.
Right.
And that payment was pretty high. It was $70,000. But again, it's not us to ask why.
Right.
So she has this loan out now.
Right.
For $250,000. This person has this loan out. And we've not had a lot of dialogue with her. And then the loan matured and she missed a payment. And we started talking and she said, I called her first time, introduced myself. She said, I'd like to renovate this house. Can you give me a loan sufficient to renovate the entire house? And then we'll sell it for like $1.1 million. I said, the short of it, I said, is maybe, but we'll come down to meet you and figure out what's going on. And so today was that day that we went down to meet her and figure out what's going on. So the first thing we got to discussing, as Sandra asked, is why does she have this loan? What brought us to this house with this person who owns this LLC? And then she said, well, as a matter of fact, I've owned this house with my mom and we bought an LLC. We put it in an LLC to become tenants. And my mom lives outside the country. And I got into a bind with a divorce and the house went to foreclosure and somebody bought it at foreclosure.
$475,000.
I'm like, for $475,000. And I said, you know, that's pretty strange because our loan was only $250,000 and you're the owner. So how'd this person buy it? So what they did was they bid at the auction. They made a small deposit on this $98,000 first trust of $14,000. They went to her door and knocked on it and said, you know what I'll do? I won't execute on my contract if you will go ahead and pay me out the $70,000. So he took a profit. He'll cancel his contract to buy it. He'll charge her $70,000. He contacted us. He put us through to her. We gave the funding for this LLC to buy it. And she ended up in the same house that she had actually lost at auction, owning it under an LLC for $250,000. And she's actually pretty darn happy about it. Right. But to find out what happened, we had to walk all the way back through this transaction.
Well, how would the foreclosing bank have agreed to sell the property?
Here's what happens. As you know, Ed, in Washington, D.C., it has to have a judicial approval.
Okay. Right? First of all, never assume I know anything. But go
why don't you explain that?
What's traditional?
Oh wait, now I have to explain it. Okay. Yeah. So
you need your caveat. Hold on. Do your caveat first.
That I'm a lawyer, but I'm not your lawyer. Yeah, this is true. So okay, I guess you did correctly assume I knew something. It's always dangerous, though. Don't assume I know anything. So judicial versus non-judicial, and I didn't even realize this until after law school how this all worked, because I thought everything was judicial. If you have a contract with somebody or a lien, you got to go to court to enforce that if they stop paying. But there are a lot of states like Virginia who think, oh, we don't want to deal with all that stuff. You people, here's the foreclosure process. You people deal with this outside of court. Follow these notice requirements. And as long as you do that, you can sell it on the courthouse steps at an auction, and it never has to see the inside of the court. But DC is a judicial foreclosure state or jurisdiction in this case. And you have to file a court action to go through the whole foreclosure process. Some are sort of halfway in between. I don't know if technically Maryland's judicial or non-judicial, but you kind of have to start a case in Maryland, but then you do it privately, and then somebody can come back to court. And of course, to further confuse things, in a non-judicial state like Virginia, somebody can bring a lawsuit over the foreclosure while it's going on, that maybe it's being done improperly. Anyway, if I haven't completely confused anything, go ahead with your story from there.
It's a monster delay.
Right. DC, it's a judicial process. So what happens is, once the gavel goes down at the foreclosure auction, which was, let's say, January 22, 2020, before COVID, the contract then has to go through another set of steps to be ratified in the court. Well, normally in Washington, D.C., that could take anywhere between 3 to 6 months to get a ratification accepted by the court. And then you go to a closing, let's say, 2 or 3 weeks later. Now, during this time frame, COVID happened and all the courts shut down for a month or two. So it took quite a long time. It was going to take quite a long time for the sale to be judicially approved. Well, in the meantime, between the time the gavel went down at the foreclosure auction and the judicial court and the judicial approval for the ratification was going on, this person talked to the occupant of the property and made a deal with the owner of the property to circumvent the foreclosure auction. So then what they did is they made a deal with the homeowner after the foreclosure sale happened, and they got $70,000, a $70,000 fee. She ended up paying her first trust back, which the payoff was only like, what, Sam, $98,000.
Mm-hmm.
And they used our $250,000 to do all of this. And the homeowner did get $30,000 or $40,000 of cash back, but she still got to own her property. She got ownership of her property. The ownership actually never conveyed. It's just that the foreclosure process got canceled and the foreclosure buyer did get his deposit back.
Plus, I see. So did the bank didn't even have to approve of this then, right? Because the first trust ultimately got paid off.
Yeah, and she was represented. I think they knocked off her late fees and stuff. It looked like a decent payoff. It didn't look bad.
Yep. And so there were no other liens or trusts against the property. There was this little small first trust amount. Now, why somebody can't pay on a $98,000 loan is beyond me. I mean, you got to be kidding me. So what we did is, because we had so much room in that particular loan, we actually built in, I need to go check, but I think we built in 3 to 6 months worth of payments.
Yeah, there was a divorce going on. There was all kind of stuff going on in that household. Transfers to the LLC, all this. The mom got ill, is 80, 90 years old. All kind of stuff going on in that situation. So I'm not sure if that was strategic, but they didn't pay the 98, so it forced it to foreclosure and pushed it out of the divorce, situation. It's hard. We didn't get a full reveal on all the underlying.
Right, but it was certainly strategic of the foreclosure winner at the auction.
Oh my gosh.
You can't even call him a foreclosure buyer, right? You're just calling him an auction.
Just a winner.
It was certainly strategic of the auction winner to collect his money, right, to collect even 70 grand. because she would have taken at least 2 to 3 years to kick at it, to get rid of her.
So he got 70 grand with no money down. Well, he put $14,000.
$14,000, which he ended up getting back.
Got that back.
Yeah.
So he put up 14, got 70 in a few weeks.
Yep. So what is there, because I'm always thinking of the next, I call these schemes, you know, there's a difference between a scheme, a plan, a scheme, and a scam, right? And what do I call it? Some of my wife, Nancy, an SSP, a scam, a scheme, or a plan in reverse order. So this sound is like a possible SSP, and the difference between scheme, which is sort of a bad thing, and a plan, which is a very good thing, is in my view often not far. And sometimes it just decides there's some random law that makes it a illegal scheme, or there's just like it's just a genius idea that. And this sounds like a genius.
I'll give him a genius.
I agree. I give it. At the beginning, it was a plan. In other words, he planned to buy it, planned to renovate it, planned to sell it. But because of the occupant,
he came up with a better plan.
They were belligerent. He then turned the plan into a scheme. So now he's created an absolutely unbelievable scheme of other folks that could do the same thing. Now, one of the questions I asked the planner / schemer, because of course we had to call him and we got him right on the phone.
This is why you guys are successful. You're always willing to learn. We learned at the
feet of a real master of this.
Oh yeah. Remember, this guy's done 4 or 5 loans with us and we have never met him once. So we're in DC and I'm like, I've got to call this guy. Not only that, but we need to meet him right now so that we can understand the plan / scheme.
Right.
We've never met him, but I'm told by this lady, this borrower, that he's very well dressed. That's how he's described as a very well.
Well, so far that's the only downside to this plan, because I'm not sure if Charlie or you could pull this off. That's the good dress.
There is no way.
Come on, I couldn't pull it off because I've been wearing this same shirt.
Oh boy.
Since Saturday, and today's Thursday, so that gives you guys an idea of how well dressed I am.
Well, that's why we need Sandra. Sandra dresses well, and she could pull that off. She could be nice.
I'm wondering though. I mean, this guy. So this is the rinse and repeat type of deal? Like he's done the same thing before?
Oh, I don't know. We should have asked him.
But I mean, yeah, you got him on the phone. You said you've done several loans with this guy. What other types of loans have you done with this guy? Nothing else like this?
He's probably done this in the past. I mean, the guy goes, matter of fact, that's how I met him in the first place was, I attended quite a few DC auctions, whether it's Harvey West or Alex Cooper. And I've met him a couple times at the auction. I don't remember who he was. Slap me on the wrist. But I've met him a couple times because that's exactly what he told me to ask. I was like, you know, LB. I'll call him LB just to make it short. I was like, Mr. LB, I said, how the heck did I meet you? Oh, he goes, oh, I've met you many times at the auction. I said, okay. So there you go.
Well, so trying to distill this down into a way that you and maybe our listeners can make some money on the. So the defining feature, it sounds to me, to repeat this, is to find a foreclosure where the number of the underlying loan is low enough there's enough equity in it. So like if you paid $400,000. Yeah. And the property was worth $500,000, this probably would not work.
Right.
It's that there was a, but if you got a, and this could happen in DC pretty easily, if you got a $200,000 buy on a $200,000 mortgage and the place is worth $400,000, you could probably do this because you've got, and the reason you might get that buy is if the thing is occupied, people are not going to necessarily want to buy it in DC because of the long judicial foreclosure process and the eviction process that follows.
Unending eviction.
But there's two risks. There's two risks. Risk number one is it has to be a low enough deed of trust payoff to where you're risking only a small deposit in case you have to lose it, right? Because the way it works is that mostly it's either 10% of the outstanding loan amount or 10% of the purchase price, whichever is lower. So in this case, it was a very low loan payoff. Now, that's risk number one. So you've got to have a low deposit in case you're going to walk from it. The second risk, and I think the most important risk, is you have to understand the ownership chain and understand that the ownership can be conveyed. Because a lot of times on properties, especially in DC, when there's a low loan amount that's being foreclosed on, odds are somebody died in the property and the property title is messy because it has a lot of estate issues. So that's the second risk on this plan slash scheme, whatever you want to call it. I'm not calling it, I mean, scheme sounds like a sort of a gnarly word, if that's a word.
That's what I mean. It sounds bad. I mean, in a plan to a scheme to a scam, it's very close.
Right.
You know, so we'll call it a plan.
It was interesting. The owner of the LLC.
Between a plan and scheme. It's definitely in between a plan and a scheme.
What made us think that it could be a scheme and not a plan is that the owner of the LLC really didn't understand what had happened.
Right.
She didn't have a clear disclosure on why she paid the money or what stopped the auction or if the house had been auctioned she knew that. Yeah, she didn't stop the auction, but she didn't understand what happened.
But she knew she had the title. No, but she knew she did not stop the auction. And she knew, in this case, we'll say who the substitute trustee was, BWW, I'll just give initials. She knew that that house got auctioned that day because she knew the person was knocking on her door after the house went to auction.
So this well-dressed man approached her before all of this happened, probably.
No, after his auction.
Probably. The day he got the house.
So the LLC, she set up on her own. She had the wherewithal to set up this LLC.
She was represented by counsel.
Right.
So whatever
full
she
disclosure,
did.
No, but full disclosure, we made her set up that LLC and convey the house to the LLC because of DC business lending laws. So we made her do that.
Right. Okay. You have to. Yeah. And here's a good drop in about the lawyers is disclosure can definitely change a scam into a plan. Right. If somebody was trying to trick her and she didn't know what she was doing, that's bad. So but if she hires an attorney and maybe the person even says wisely, here's what I can do. And in fact, I want you, and in fact, I will require you to get an attorney because I want to make sure this is all above board and, you know, you're not a real estate professional. I want to make sure they explain it to you. The lawyer then looks at it and says, yeah, your option is fight this out and eventually you'll get evicted or you can get your house back. And this is a good deal. It's a really smart resolution.
It's a great resolution. It was a win-win for both sides. Just because, like I told her today, I was like, look, LB actually bailed you out and enabled you to re-own your house. You should be absolutely thrilled. And he did not really take that much money. I mean, people might think, oh yeah, he made 70 grand and, you know, got his $14,000 back. But honestly, at the end of the day, $70,000 is a crapshoot. He did, you know, he was nice in my book. He was generous.
Yeah, I think so. Why didn't he go for the 1 point whatever million that this?
Right, because he bought a 445, but at the time, though, Sandra, it was probably worth about 850, and then it was going to need, in our estimation, about $150,000 to get it renovated. So what's that?
Oh, all day.
150 is 600, and then fees and all that. So again, he probably had
and had 2 to 3 years of holding costs and risk in the middle of COVID. Now that that's exiting in DC, you're still talking about a lot of risk. As you guys know, Sam and Joe, what if there had been a renter in there? Oh my
God. Well, not only that, but remember entering into COVID, we thought the market was going to go to a hell in a handbasket really quick and we were going to lose value. We didn't know it was going to increase. So remember, we were really nervous about COVID. We thought values were going down, not up.
Right. It's always, if you have perfect information, the person like Sandra said, you might think, gee, I left $100,000 on the table, let's say. On the other hand, you cut your risk off. One of the things about this business, when you know for a fact you're walking away with $70,000 or you've got a big mystery box, like with the question mark on it, And it's like what was the old show where you'd pick behind what the curtains you know,
let's make a deal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so Curtin won, or that he offers you the cash, right? He goes, all right, here's the $70,000 in cash, or you can open up Curtin number one and see what you won. And it's sometimes it's like a goat. They'd have like a goat right behind the curtain. Yeah. And one of the, you know, then you take the money, you open up the curtain. It's like a trip to Cancun and a car and like all this great stuff. So it's all risk management at the end of the day.
And then literally curtain number three is a number two.
Exactly. It's genius. But it sounds like it's potentially replicatable in DC. I guess it depends on, but it is a risk though when you're getting into it. Sounds like to some extent he got himself into this purchase and then figured, let me investigate what the best way is to dispose of this. And you know, but even in your estate situation, you could go back and approach a representative of the estate and sell it back to the estate.
Yeah,
you know, potentially. As long as they have a proper trustee or whatever. This is how do we get this guy on staff?
We could have him on the show if he'd be willing.
Yeah,
he might. But in this scenario, though, at both parties, I want to say the former / current owner was represented by a lawyer, and the purchaser at the auction, they had a lawyer. So, like you said, I mean, it was definitely above board. So it's definitely between the scheme and the plan, right? That's where the arrow's pointing. So.
Oh, I think it's solidly a plan. A scheme is just, it's one of those things that people look at and they say, that doesn't seem right, but it's legal, you know, or it's complicated, you know. Plan is just totally normal. It's only the scam that's illegal. When you're scamming, that's, you know, somebody catches you, you're going to jail.
Well, we could have a new title here. Between a scheme and a scam.
Between
a scheme and a plan.
The title is SSP.
Yeah.
That's title.
Yeah. SSP. No, that's and the other thing is, this is a winner. This is like a winner chicken dinner.
Everyone was happy at the end.
Yeah. Everybody.
Well, and that's what's I philosophize too much, but that's kind of what's fascinating about real estate or about good business deals or whatever. And not to get political, they say, like, Donald Trump always believed he didn't have a good deal if the other side didn't lose. You know, he wanted to extract every dollar from but in a good business deal and a good real estate deal, everybody can win. Yeah. And here it sounds like the original bank won. They got their money. The homeowner won. They got their home back. This guy who facilitated this plan, as we've deemed it, got his money, and everybody sounds like is happy. Mm-hmm. And you feel good about that. You know, you go to sleep well at night that you've done a good.
Don't forget the hard money guys. They're absolutely thrilled.
Oh yeah, that's right. Then the outside vendors, and and then if she refinances this and renovates it and sells it, there's going to be money made on that, you know, hiring all the workers, and it's all good. And then people make money. I'm just happy. You made me happy today. You know how rare this is?
I'm so glad. And you know what? We love that happy haircut. That makes me happy.
Everyone made some money off of this woman's potential misfortune that did not happen.
Yeah, I mean, really, let's look at on the other side of things. Let's say he would have bought it for $475 like he was supposed to at the auction. Well, the person in the house would have gotten $475 minus the payoff of the loan. Let's say it's $100,000. Sam, what'd you say it was? $98,95?
Mm-hmm.
So she would have got $475 minus, let's say it's $100, but then the trustee would have got probably, let's say, a 5% commission. So that's about $25,000. So she would have got $475 minus $175 or $125. So she would have got, $350,000 sent right back to her. So she would have got $350, but she would have had to move out of a house that she had been in for over 25 years. Mm-hmm. And she has a lot of emotional attachment to the house. So, I mean, you got to weigh, you know, 350, 25 years, I got to get kicked out of the house, which that would have been a mean eviction. And she was running up legal fees anyway on her lawyer's side too. So I don't know.
No, she made out. I mean, she definitely made out.
Relatively.
Yeah, and I think she yanked it out from under her estranged husband as well. So I think there was some more scheme plan activity that we weren't.
I'm thinking that, you know, this well-dressed man probably had some role in all of this.
Yeah.
you think it was a situation where he got a little more than this 70?
I think so. It just seems too convenient that he was there for our house in Columbia Heights.
Okay, well, I won't go into the whole descriptive reasoning why I don't think this is what happened, but I'll just leave it there.
Yeah. Hey, look.
You could be right.
That's strange. A little intuition, Sam. That's
just a little cheek.
Little cheek down there.
Well, it's always possible, but you know, a lot of things in life and with business, right, is timing and information. And so, again, this is from the theory side, I think, of business. If she had perfect information and understood the process, setting aside the husband thing, probably the best thing for her would have been to go refinance the property. But if you're a regular homeowner and you're being foreclosed on and you figure your credit's terrible, which it's going to be, and you can't go to a bank, which you can't because they ain't going to give you a loan, you figure you're out of luck and you get foreclosed on. But in reality, if people understood, somebody like her could go to a private lender. And if her attorney was smart enough to explain the situation, say, wait a second, you have all this equity in this house and you can't go to, you know, Citibank. They can't give you a Fannie Mae back loan, but you could get a higher priced, you know, private lending loan would be a good resolution. That might have been a better result for her, but it took this other outside fellow. I'm betting she just probably didn't know what to do to stop the foreclosure and didn't have the income due to a divorce, right? Or a medical emergency. That happens all the time.
No, you're right, Ed. That's exactly what the problem was. Come on, think about it, right? She didn't know us. She didn't know us, and she didn't know anything about the private lending space / hard money. So what happened was, is she only owed less than $100,000 on an asset, let's just say it was worth $800,000. Anybody in their right mind, except banks, if they were an asset-based lender, would give her a loan. Well, hell, we would have given her a loan for $150,000 and given her $50,000 worth of payments for a couple of years. We didn't care. We would have figured something out because we're an asset-based lender. But these banks, for whatever reason, your credit score doesn't check the box. Your income doesn't check the box. This doesn't check the box. I'm not checking the box, so I can't give you a loan. Okay. Well, you foreclosed on her, so.
Right. Yeah. And I wouldn't have known until knowing you guys and learning. I mean, I had no idea there was a real private lending market like this that would be available to people because it does vary a lot by, you know, there's the lawyer thing. You gotta see what loans can be set up, how, you know, and then you get the skeptical people like Sandra who thinks, you know,
a little love is involved.
Yeah.
She's a romantic.
Maybe a little bit of that. Maybe a little
She's
bit
romantic.
Of that.
What's wrong with a little love?
They live happily ever after in this house that, you know, now I've watched too many TV shows, you know, that just kind of have that twist at the end and plot. So now she and Mr. Well-Dressed Man are living in this house. So that's all.
I hope could there be a twist? Yeah, that's what Sam and Charlie are always watching out for, right? It's the twist in the plot where the hard money lender gets screwed. You don't want to have that happen. That would be bad.
I have to admit, I was sitting there, Ed, when she was telling us this story about the foreclosure auction. I was literally sitting there shitting bricks because I'm like, oh my gosh, we missed something on the title search. Actually the second trust when we think we're the first trust and we're going to have to go to court on this thing. I'm sitting there thinking that the whole time because she's sitting there telling us, yeah, well, this guy, he bought the house at foreclosure auction at 475 and BWW auctioned it off. And I'm thinking to myself, honey, we only got a $250,000 loan against this house. What the heck am I missing?
I couldn't wait to get out of there to figure this out. We figured out while we were sitting there.
Yeah.
Well, but it's true. This is also the risk management side. And again, for our listeners, when you get involved in this, and I know Sandra wants you to get the 299. Well, she wants the 299 lawyer for herself. She's not recommending that, but for terms of risk management with these deals, right? It's kind of fascinating that there's a lot of risk with homes, right? There's title. Does somebody really own the home? Is it really the person? It says on the title, Tom Jones owns the home. Is this really Tom Jones, or is this some guy pretending to be Tom Jones? Where's the money getting wired? Has the house burned down? Maybe somebody gets really ticked off and the whole process burns the house down. So all of these are real risks, but all of them can be protected against, right? So people are generally familiar with title insurance, and that's part of the why if anybody's ever bought a home, they're like, why do I have to pay $2,000 in title insurance? You know, it just seems like it's enough. You know, you're more likely to have this problem in a private lending situation in a regular home, but you could. And so the banks protect them that way. You have to make sure there's insurance on the house so it doesn't get burned down. There's, what is it, Sam? CPL insurance?
Closing protection letter.
Protection letter to make sure that Tom Jones really is Tom Jones, which I guess what they just verify with a driver's license typically. I don't even know how they do that.
It's driver's license for the most part.
I mean, that could probably be faked.
Or a state ID. Yeah. Well, it could be.
Yeah. So all of these are they're real risks that have to be paid attention to. And so I'm sure Charlie and Sam, you get that drop in the pit of your stomach where you're thinking, did something slip through the cracks? And that's why hard money lenders charge a decent amount of interest, because there is risk, usually more the risk of being like stuck in a foreclosure action or a bankruptcy for a long period of time. But it can be having to unwind some title disaster, even though you may have insurance. It tends to be limited. It's not going to protect your profit on a deal and whatever the case is. So maybe try to make sure you've got that good lawyer. Wait a second, I'm promoting lawyers now? This is all your fault, Sandra, that I'm promoting lawyers.
I at some point I may have to, kind of go back on that $399 lawyer. I think
you gave him the $100 raise.
I came up $100. It's okay. Worth another $100 to me. Okay. You've schooled me. I know enough now that I'll pay another $100.
She'll pay another $100. I'm Ed's agent right now. I don't think Ed's gonna accept that.
It is kind of crazy how much lawyers charge, quite honestly. I mean, literally, I always used to laugh when I was at the big law firm. People go out and they dig ditches and teach classes and design buildings. And literally, somebody calls me up and I go, and I just sort of stroke my chin like an evil, scientist. And I say, okay, that'll be $500. I did that for an hour. I've just been sitting there thinking for an hour. And I thought, this is a pretty good deal, actually. It's not hard work. this poor fella in the suit is out there hitting the streets and going to auctions and doing it, not getting paid, constantly not getting paid because he doesn't get anything to finally get that deal. Yeah.
That's funny.
Yeah, but that's the way life works, I guess. Yeah.
It's another wrap. You should like us on whatever medium you're listening to us on and send us a note.
Just like us. Just please like us. Even if you don't click the like, we want to be liked.
Send us a question. Send us a story, your story at basementtales.com.
This was a story today. And subscribe so you don't miss. Don't miss the next days of our lives.
Please subscribe. Please comment. Anything's appreciated. We get a lot of oral feedback from folks, but I mean, we'd like to maybe answer some of your questions online and that kind of thing. So.
Oh, which reminds me, and this, I think this is aired, there was a question about bankruptcy and where you file bankruptcy. And I took a look. There's a rule about if you've lived a certain amount of period in a jurisdiction, that's where you're supposed to file bankruptcy. And it can get more complicated from that and consult your lawyer. And but it just goes to show you, even a fantastic, highly compensated lawyer that isn't like yourself.
Isn't 180-day window? And then if you're at one place for 91 days, that's kind of where you do it.
Right. And I'm sure there's exceptions if you have property in multiple states and where you live. And because, you know, you can't charge $500 an hour a lawyer unless it's complicated, if it's just a simple rule. But generally speaking, I believe that's correct. And it also shows you that, I mean, I've been a lawyer for a long time and I've been involved in bankruptcy stuff. Never really occurred to me because it's not that often an issue. So, you know, that's the main thing lawyers do. I mean, some they just know from experience, but a lot of times you just got to look up the answer. It's what they're, and you know how to use Google. It used to be called Westlaw, but you know how to Google things and understand them. But anyway, okay, that's all. That's a post-show bonus episode right there.